It's important to keep in mind that the collapse of communist regimes in Eastern Europe and then the overthrow of the Communist Party in the Soviet Union and then the dissolution of the Soviet Union as a federation of 15 republics took place after the Cold War ended. And the result, the processes were connected with each other, but it was not a clear-cut case of one side winning and the other side losing. You might say, yes, capitalism won over communism, right? But when you begin to deconstruct it, these mega terms, you will discover that it's not that simple. You can also make a case that, which, by the way, the case that was made by George Soros, one of the most famous capitalists of them all. A few years ago, he published an interesting book, which was called The Capitalist Threat, in which he made a case that now that communism is no longer in the role that it played in the Cold War, kind of competing with capitalism, capitalism is in danger from itself. That's what he meant by saying the capitalist threat. So for capitalism to be more healthy, you have to have an alternative. You have to have some kind of ideological competition. You have to have systemic competition that actually helps maintain capitalism in a better condition. So if you can say that it was a great victory for one side and a loss for the other side, that raises some questions. And also, if the Russians took this initiative in dismantling the old system and then dismantling the Soviet Union as a federation, which resulted in the drastic reduction of Russia's international power and influence. If they did all that, did they do it because they were frightened? Did they do it because they were kind of throwing in the towel? No, they did it because they thought that this kind of a policy turn was best for Russia. And in some respects it was true, in other respects it was a big mistake. Because the transition to capitalism in Russia turned out to be catastrophic. How can it be otherwise when you lose half of your economy in a matter of 2 or 3 years? When inflation jumps up to the level of 4 digits a year. Imagine what's like living through that kind of a crisis. That's like double the big whammy of the Great Depression that the Americans experienced. And also, Russia was now stuck when the Soviet Union, see, there was a country with centralized government, federal government, and with government of 15 republics, units of the federation called the Soviet Union. So when that structure is dissolved by the decision of some of the republic leaders, the restoration of the basic functions of government in each of the republics is an enormously complicated job. By the way, when we are examining the continuing crisis in Ukraine, which is a failed state by any definition, we should think of the Russian revolutions, dissolution of the Soviet Union in 91, or the collapse of the Russian Empire in 1917. Overthrowing a government can be an easy thing. But then living through the chaos and trying to rebuild some kind of a state usually takes years, and sometimes it doesn't work. Sometimes you lose a state as a result of the inability to restore the political structures which are the basic underpinnings of any society worthy of the name. So, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the overthrow of the Soviet government was actually a result of a failed competition between opposing factions without the Soviet Union. So there were reformers there, there were hardliners, and would have been better for everyone if those two factions had not had maintained some sort of a civilized competition, and then democratically the Soviet Union might have achieved a different kind of a result. Instead, they went at each other in a zero-sum game, and the Soviet Union had to be dissolved. So it was a failure of policy making, it was a failure of leadership, it was a tragedy. For peoples living in the Soviet Union, it was a tragedy. They lost a lot, they gained something as a result, but we have to really maintain, to recognize that it was not a simple case, okay, they were defeated in the Cold War, So any attempt of people living in the post-Soviet space to cooperate and create some sort of international organizations is bad by definition. That's revisionism. That means returning to the Cold War. So the post-Cold War period, starting with 1991, the post-Cold War, the post-Soviet period, can be neatly divided into two stages. The first stage, from 1991 to roughly year 2000. Russia was going through this catastrophic transformation. What was the American role then? The United States, for the first time in the history of relations between the two states, became deeply involved in transforming Russia. Deeply involved in counseling, guiding economic reforms, political reforms, and even foreign policy. In terms of foreign policy, in that decade, Russia accepted the leadership of the United States. Sometimes they would differ, sometimes they would fume against some American actions, but the fundamentals were, listen, the U.S. is now the only superpower remaining, and our best bet, because of the domestic difficulties and so on and so forth, because of economic troubles, we shouldn't challenge the United States. Okay? So, on the one hand, the West was trying to help the transformation. On the other hand, the West, as could be expected, was taking advantage of the vacuum of power that emerged in Eurasia with the collapse of the Soviet Union. Nature abhors vacuum. Yes, the US government and the German government did promise Gorbachev in 1990, when the question was whether the Germans, East and West, should be allowed to reunite, that NATO would not move an inch from the borders of the time. It's an interesting discourse. There was no document signed, it was just oral promise. And whenever the issue crops up again and the Russians begin to charge that the Americans violated yet another promise, they promised not to expand NATO eastward, and they did. The response is always, but look, there were so many countries between you guys and Western Europe who felt insecure, so they were asking, we were not imposing NATO on those people. They needed security, and they were concerned, and so NATO was open, and at some point, you know, one after another, they all became members of NATO. What's more, you Russians can also become members of NATO if you want, under some conditions, sometime in the future, but we don't know when that's going to happen. So the expansion of NATO eastward was happening in a kind of a non-confrontational, semi-friendly fashion. But I will never forget a conversation which I had in Brussels at NATO headquarters. In 1997, I was a member of a group of Canadian academics who came there to see how NATO works. We spent a week there, saw a lot of interesting things, including the inside of an AWACS plane. We didn't fly, we just, you know, passed through. But there was this briefing on NATO enlargement, which was conducted by a British general and an American general. And the British guy was the first, and he was typical British aristocrat who gave us a wonderful, wonderful picture of how NATO's expansion eastward was making everyone happier and secure and so on and so forth. And then came the turn of the American general. He was not as polished as the British counterpart. But he went through the routines of explaining how expansion worked, and then he said something that few people expected from him. He said, you know, I may be simple-minded, but I have a problem with this constant expansion of NATO, because, you know, as a soldier, I'm thinking, don't kick the Russians when they're down, because they will get back on their feet, and they won't forget. And we kind of looked at each other and said, ain't this guy, he's a Russian spy there or something? No, he was a decorated American general in his mid-50s, and he just spoke his mind. Because power politics and geopolitics cannot be canceled out of existence just because we want to do so. And the balances of power have been the fundamental tectonic plates of the political planet on which we live. And so, yes, if the balance of power changes drastically against one important country, that it is to be expected that at some point that country will begin to push back. It's in the nature of international politics. Now, if the new balance of power, which gives that particular country a lessened role in world affairs, is objectionable to those who, I mean, if the new balance of power is in the interests of the other participants, then the other participants would try and prevent the changes from taking place. And if Russia has begun its pushback, as it has in recent years, it didn't happen now in the Ukraine, it's been happening for several years now. If Russia decided to somewhat change the balance of power in Eurasia in its favor, because the reduced status, the reduced influence that it had was creating problems and insecurities in Russia, we have to accept it as part of the way the world works. Just that we have to accept it that the United States and the Europeans would be somewhat concerned about that and would be trying to prevent it. So what we are witnessing now is a renewed geopolitical competition where everybody understands that it's in the nature of things, and everybody kind of plays by the rules which are familiar, and everybody of course presents their own side in the best possible light while bashing the other side as being the violator of international order or mortal change to the global security and so on and so forth. Been there, done that. So the issue is whether these changes in the balance of power, regional balance of power, global balance of power, should necessarily lead to big conflicts, or whether they can be contained within a framework which is flexible enough, and where the terms of those changes can be negotiated. An even bigger and more important change in the global balance of power is occurring in Asia, because China is likely to become the world's leading economy, and the new containment of China in some form is already part of the official policy of the United States. Does this mean that at some point the United States would be prepared to obliterate China with nuclear weapons just to remove the threat, much as Mao Zedong was advocating in the late 1950s? No, it doesn't follow. It doesn't follow, because changes in power balances within the country and on the global scale happen all the time. Which brings me to the issue of Russia's resurgence, and I've been testing your patience for much too long, so I should be bringing it to a conclusion, even though there are so many good points that I have to share with you, but maybe in my response to the question. So Putin is associated with the resurgence of Russia. If you look at the stats for rates of economic growth, political stability, standard of living, the incomes, pensions, and so on and so forth, and compare the Russia of the 1990s to the Russia of the past decade and a half, the contrasts are stark. So Russia has really been resurgent in some respects. It's still a country which has enormous issues, enormous flaws and weaknesses, and so on and so forth. And what's more, this resurgence, which is to a large degree attributable to the fact that Russia has restored something like a functioning state at the price of abandoning partially liberal democratic principles, which were proclaimed as the founding principles of the new Russia back in the early 1990s. So for the Russians, it's a very important dilemma. Putin's style of governance helps Russia overcome its past chaos and strengthen its state, but at what price? Is that price acceptable? Is that price too high? Can we change the terms in the next election so as we protect the fragile democratic institutions from further erosions under the pressure of authoritarian rulers? These are the questions which the Russians are dealing with. They're complex questions. And political culture jumps into the fray, because you can so easily persuade the Russians to forget for maybe another generations about liberal democratic principles if the survival of the nation is at stake. So this complex of insecurity that exists in the mind of every Russian almost at the level of your spinal cord, and as a Russian, I'm familiar with it. Russia without a state is a tragedy writ large across 11 time zones of Eurasia. And by the way, I would like to repeat the point. I think that it can be taken as a given that massive destabilization of Russia is regarded the world over as a global problem, pregnant with all kinds of bad scenarios. So that's why, by the way, Putin's authoritarianism was plain, obvious for everyone to see from day one. And yet, there was this remarkable cooperation and even friendship between the likes of George Bush, for instance, very interested in promotion of democracy by various means, and Vladimir Putin, who was jailing some billionaires who challenged to him politically and so on and so forth. So what situation in U.S.-Russian relations presented us with in the past few years when President Obama began his first term was an attempt to rationalize and improve relations between the two countries, which would accept the fact that Russia is no longer a basket case, Russia is resurgent, and Russia is probably entitled to some increase in its international influence. And we saw under the rubric of the reset, as it was called, some very, very serious progress in relations between Russia and the United States. And it continued all the way to 2012, and then the inevitable, as it has happened before, every time it moves in the direction of better relations, things begin to come to the fore which divide the two countries and new issues appear. So what were the divisive issues? What are the divisive issues now? Divisive issues, if you will. Number one, Russia is determined to pursue reintegration of the post-Soviet space, meaning the countries which once were republics of the Soviet Union. Russia is doing this by appealing to the economic and power interests in those neighboring states and offering them terms of trade and economic integration, which some of them find hard to refuse. This is what the reintegration of the post-Soviet space is. Now, the security agenda is also there. So cultivating deeper integration is expected to become the post-Soviet neighborhood safer for Russia, safer from, for instance, further expansion of NATO. Second thing, the United States openly supports opposition forces in Russia. And it's consistent with the idea of promoting and helping revolutions in various places. Middle East is a case in point. The Arab Awakening was enthusiastically met in the United States. And in fact, there was this enthusiasm about the overthrow of authoritarian regimes and the people's power that follows. So, but in the case of Russia, there was an open siding of the United States with the forces that were against Mr. Putin's return to the presidency in 2012. It came to a point where Vice President Biden supposedly directly told Mr. Putin, Vladimir, we don't think it would be a good idea for you to run for the president again. If I had been advising Vice President Biden, that would be the first thing that I would have advised him not to do. But he's notorious for saying things which sometimes are politically incorrect, as we know. But I mean, having heard that from your American friend, the first thing that you do, yes, I will run for president. And that's sort of the typical Russian response. You don't tell us what we should do with our government and so on and so forth. That's the kind of the mental construct that arises at this point. The third point is that Russia has been growing more and more insecure about the military balance between Russia and the West. And that balance is not in favor of Russia. And in fact, with the new military technologies coming to the fore, new forms, new types of weapons, new forms of war making, which are on the horizon or are already here, Russia feels that its investment in its security must be renewed. So they've started a process of military modernization. They still spend one-tenth of what the Americans are spending. And every time I look at the statistics and see that the United States spends 10 times as much as the Russians, my question is America 10 times as insecure as Russia? Russia has 13 neighbors, more than any other country. When the Russians look east, they see the friendly Chinese faces. But when they count the number of faces on their side of the border and on the Chinese side of the border, they get a bit uneasy. Also, when they say weapons to China, and the Chinese are quick to copy and then mass produce the same weapons under different names, well, they are friends. They are friendly neighbors, and they cooperate in a lot of things, including keeping the United States at bay, if it works. But the thing is, with NATO expanding from the West, with China there rapidly rising in its international influence, and with a huge Muslim world being not just on the southern border of Russia, but with the being part of Russia, because there are 20% of the population of Russia are culturally, or in full terms, in terms of religion, Muslims. So Russia is part and parcel of the Muslim world. It's not isolated from it. So when you think, and also the unfreezing Arctic, which poses huge issues in terms of the regimes of shipping, access to the hydrocarbon resources on the seabed, access to the fisheries, and so on and so forth. And Russia has more territory in the Arctic than any other country. So you would think that with this kind of an environment, the huge Russian state would be spending a little more on things connected with defense. Than just one-tenth of the United States, which, and you know how many bases Russia has outside, international foreign bases on foreign soil? That's about 15. The United States has more than 500. But, of course, their roles are not the same. The American role is to maintain a certain international order. Russia is not in the business of global governance. Russia can be a partner in the global partner governance project together with the Russians, or it can be a challenger to that order, but it's not on the same level. And by the way, it never has been. And that's something that we should keep in mind. Even though the two superpowers were seemingly equals in terms of influence in the world, they never were. The United States always had commanding heights. The Russians were always in the position of challengers. In fact, it's useful with some degree of oversimplification to compare relations in the global order, relations between the Soviet Union representing revolutionary forces, socialism, and so on, and the United States representing the world of capitalism, to labor relations and General Motors, and relations between the management and the unions, where they can fight over the terms of the contract, and each side is prepared to go far in pushing for their interests, but at the end of the day, they must be in the business of making cars. So to keep the world going and moving forward, as it did during the Cold War, was a joint concern of both superpowers, even though their roles were not equal.